The JLR interview series.
All right, so it's Tuesday, 23rd of October, just after 11 a.m. and Jazz London Radio has another interview this morning with Lorraine Baker. Lorraine is a young drummer coming through on the scene, and it's really good to have her on the station. So how are you this morning?
I'm good, thank you. I'm well rested from the last few gigs.
Okay, I should say to the listeners, it's a phone interview, so bear with us on this one. It's not the best line, but I'm sure we'll be absolutely fine. So really, am I being playing some of Lorraine's tracks on the latest releases slot? The CD was sent to me, and I must admit I really enjoyed it, so I thought it'd be a nice idea to get her on to Jazz London Radio just to talk about herself and her music so far. I'd say she's one of the young up-and-coming musicians coming through, and one thing I would say, there is definitely a lot of interesting talent coming through in this country at the moment. So Ray, the first question is, so the debut release is called Eden, and is it just to be released, or is it just being released?
October.
Oh, so it's just been released. Okay, so about a week, just over a week ago, 2 weeks even. Okay, so you know, the first question is, you know, I think it's an interesting concept. But before I ask you any questions, can you tell the listeners about, you know, about the album, please?
Sure. Well, I've had the project in mind for quite a few years. I've always been a massive fan of Ed Blackwell's playing. And all the musicians that he's played with, and I thought it would just be a really good idea to get an album together of his tunes that he's played on from different times in his life, and also use it as a platform to show off my improvisations, and also to put a great modern band together as well. So that's how we came up with the concept of Eden.
Okay, so now I say this is your debut release, isn't it?
Right.
I have to say, I mean, it's not a bad concept for a debut release.
Thanks. yes, I mean, like I say, it's taken quite a few years to finalise the ideas and get them together. So, yeah, I'm pleased to be finally touring it now.
No, good. And you know, Ed Blackwell, I mean, obviously a really great artist, great musician, and you know, he's passed on such a long time ago, long before you were born, I would suspect, as well.
Yes, he was born in 1929, so, and he died sort of fairly young. He died in 1992, so that was way before I'd even discovered jazz. So I first heard Ed Blackwell when I was at college, actually, Trinity Laban in Greenwich, and that's when I first discovered his playing.
And what is it about his playing that, you know, grabbed your attention so much, would you say?
I think two things. The first thing, he demonstrates just a connection with the listener or the audience. Something that I think is really, really important for engaging people in improvisation and in jazz gigs in general. The second thing is an unmistakable joyfulness in his playing, sort of like a dance-like quality. Often he improvises over a pulse, and it's quite sort of a repetitive thing, and the ideas kind of flow out of each other. So I really got that feeling of joy when I was listening to his improvisations, and I thought that was quite different from anything else I'd heard.
Okay, so... You know, obviously he did a lot of interesting things. I think he played with Mingus, is that correct? Ed Blackwell, or am I wrong on that?
Yes, he did a little bit, and he also, mainly he played with Ornette Coleman.
Oh yes, of course.
He did a brief touring stint with Ray Charles as well, which is a bit sort of one of his earlier things in his career.
So he was quite a diverse musician as well. I mean, I heard some of his stuff in the early 90s, his own music. So he had some interesting guys he'd play with as well, like Don Cherry.
Yes.
I'm not sure he played with Don Pullen, but he might have done. I would imagine they were similar kingships. But yeah, that's amazing. And, you know, looking at drummers from that era as well, you know, you mentioned his musicality. And that's the thing, you know, the other drummers from that period, especially Billy Higgins comes to mind immediately, who also had that quality. So even if they were playing what we might call avant-garde, they did it in such a way that it was so musical and so upbeat. It's amazing.
Yes, exactly. It's great to listen to.
Have you heard of a drummer called Joe Chambers?
Yes, I have.
Yeah, he is another one of that ilk. He played a lot with Bobby Hutcherson. He was an incredible drummer. Okay, so yeah, so that's out. So I say, and you know, obviously we talked a lot about why you put this CD together. Now to bring it to your CD itself. So, I mean, it's really, I say, it's an outstanding release. The tunes are really, you know, flow really nicely. Your drumming is top notch. All the musicians are playing really well. Was it a struggle to put the CD together? Was it fairly easy? You know, the sessions?
The sessions were, it was 2 days worth of sessions. So before the sessions, myself and the bass player, Paul Michael, we worked a lot on the arrangements and the kind of grooves that we wanted to get into the tunes and the direction and feel of how we wanted them. So we did a lot of kind of pre-planning a bit of how we wanted the session to go, because we knew that we wouldn't get, you know, because it's a really, really nice studio, we recorded it in East Coast Studios, so we wouldn't have the budget to do a lot of time there. So with the 2 days, we really had to concentrate it into, you know, the 2 days, and that's why, you know, there's not sort of so many tunes on the album, but we wanted it to be quite a compact thing.
And you said you took some, you know, famous tunes he played on. Did you change them up a lot, or did you stick to the original tunes themselves?
We did alter them slightly. I mean, also myself and Paul had some of our own ideas that we wanted to put into the tunes, which took them in a different direction. In terms of the actual tunes we used, we did try out quite a few other tunes as well that aren't on the album. So on the live gigs, we'll be playing quite a few of those, which is quite nice. So yeah, that's a really good thing to catch us on a live gig if you can.
Yeah, okay, that's good. And you know, also I should ask you as well, how did you, you know, get into drumming and music?
Sure, well, I started reasonably late. I was 12 years old.
Okay.
And I actually did tap dancing classes beforehand.
Really?
Which I really enjoyed. I did ballet as well, but I found it very difficult, and I didn't like it as much as the rhythmic thing in the tap dancing. So, yes, and then I was given just a pair of knitting needles and an old sweet tin, and I used to make a racket on that in my bedroom, just messing around. And my mum sort of burst into the room, and I thought she was going to tell me off, but she actually said, "Would you like to have some drum tuition?"
Wow.
Which was great, because that was the start of, you know, my whole career, basically.
Wow, that's interesting. And so you said you went to Trinity Laban?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. And, you know, who are some of the drummers that you looked up to or you listened to as you're learning your craft? Some of the drummers, doesn't have to be jazz, any field.
Sure, I mean, yeah, I mean, before I went to college, I was listening to kind of rock and pop artists. I was listening to, The Police, so Stuart Copeland, things like that. Any person who has just really got a kind of gutsy feel, you know. So also, I mean, when I was at college, I got to meet Dave Wickens, who's a really, really interesting drummer. I also got to meet Gene Cutterazzo as well, who is obviously plays with part who had a really different approach. It was great to have these two teachers of just such different styles as well, and being able to learn things from both of those, you know. So I learned a great deal from both of those teachers, and I have to say, I do look up to them both a lot.
Okay, that's interesting. Yeah, Gene Cataract, he's been on the scene quite a while now. His brother's a really good piano player.
Yes.
But Gene came to England seemingly quite early in his career.
Yes.
Okay. And, you know, it's something that I would like to ask. But so I interviewed an Italian drummer, actually, last week, Monday. She's from Rome. Her name's Cecilia Sanchietti. And she's also a composer. She's brought out a couple of albums. And she actually really produced some interesting compositions. So, you know, she talked about how she got into drumming. She actually started later than you. She was a piano player. I think she said she started around the age of 17 or something like that.
Right.
Which is incredible, considering how good she is.
Mm.
But she did touch upon about being a woman, a female drummer, you know, composer, and, you know, people's perceptions of drummers anyway. And there are quite a few, you know, female drummers in the British scene right now who have been, you know, around for a while.
Mm-hmm.
Sophie Alloway, Cheryl Elaine, to name two. How do you find it for you as a female drummer coming through, especially as a composer?
Yeah, I mean, like you say, there are more and more female drummers and band leaders, composers out there now. I must say, quite honestly, it's never really been a thing that's been at the front of my mind.
Mm.
In terms of sort of getting work and just going about my career, really.
Mm.
I mean, being left-handed as well, that's another kind of issue.
Oh,
that,
like Billy Cobham.
Something's quite different. So often had people, you know, comment that, you know, I'm female and left-handed. It's like that kind of rare combination, which is quite funny. But no, I must say, I've never experienced any setbacks with it myself, mm-hmm. personally, and I definitely encourage, you know, any of my students to, just pursue it, you know.
Yeah, okay, that's good. You've got students as well, of course. Well, that's the thing, isn't it? I suppose as time moves on, you know, the generations before who might have to put up with things that hopefully you won't have to put up with,
yes.
that they've made a way to make it hopefully for easier for people like you coming through now, and then your students who are coming through at a later date.
Absolutely, and I've got some excellent students as well, so it's looking really promising.
Oh, that's good. Okay. All right, so just to finish up now, so, well, first of all, can you just tell us, the listeners, what your website is?
Yes, so my website is www.lorrainebaker.co.uk.
Mm-hmm. And so on there, would it have to, you said you've got a tour coming up, so would the dates be on there?
Yes, so I'm currently starting the tour. We've done 4 dates, and we've got 19 in total, and all the dates are on the website.
All the dates on the website. Alright, excellent. So, you know, thanks for the interview this morning with Jazz on the Radio, and I actually look forward to seeing you play in one of your gigs.
You're welcome, thank you.
Okay, thanks. We'll be right back.
The JLR Interview Series.